Namaskar and welcome back to Aviation Abhi. Go where you feel the most alive. We are back on Aviation Abhi with another video on the global reporting format. And with this video, we will understand the background of GRF. What is GRF? How is GRF significant and how is it different from the previously present reporting formats? Moving on, we will understand the role of stakeholders involved in the process of RCR reporting, and which are the aerodrome operator, the aircraft crew and the ATC. Further, we will understand the basic terms involved in RCR generation like the runway condition code and the RCAM matrix. This will be the first part of the video, and the second part of the video will include the assessment of RCR and the adjustment of RCR, and we will understand the entire concept of global reporting format in the second part with an example. So without any delay, let's get started. So let us start with the background of the global reporting format. The GRF was developed by the International Civil Aviation Organization to mitigate the risks of runway excursions, that is, the wearing off of the wheels of the aircraft from the runway. The GRF has its origin in the US. FAA Takeoff and Landing Performance Assessment Aviation Rulemaking Committee and subsequent initiatives. The TALPA ARC was formed in December 2005 following a fatal runway excursion at Chicago Midway Airport. Its purpose was to make recommendations on improving safety of runway operations on wet or contaminated runway for both takeoff and landing. So ICAO began work on what became GRF in the year 2008 with the formation of Friction Task Force, comprising of 10 member states and 7 international organizations. And finally, the global reporting format became globally applicable on 4th of November 2021 after being delayed by a year because of the COVID-19 pandemic. So, how is GRF different from the existing reporting formats? And how does GRF benefit us? GRF provides a standardized reporting of runway surface conditions. GRF provides a common language and one system for all stakeholders at an aerodrome, that is the aerodrome operator, the ATC, the AIM, the MET and the pilots. The pilots can accurately determine the takeoff and landing performance based on GRF. It enhances situational awareness and improves decision making. GRF provides improved aerodrome safety and fewer runway excursions or accidents. And finally, it provides improved operations efficiency. So these are the benefits from GRF. So now that we have understood the background of GRF and we have understood how is GRF beneficial to us, let us dive in and understand the steps involved in generation of RCR and understand what are the roles of the stakeholders, the first being the airside operations team, that is from the aerodrome operators team. So whenever there is a change in runway condition or runway surface because of contaminant, that may be water, snow, slush, ice on the runway, an assessment of RCR is made by a trained personnel from the airside operations team. And this assessment means the trained personnel goes on the runway and performs a runway inspection and determines the coverage of contaminant, the depth of the contaminant and the type of contaminant on the runway. And using this information, the personnel forms a RCR using the RCAM. And this information is disseminated to the AIS and or the ATS for dissemination to the pilots. When the runway is wholly or partly contaminated by standing water, snow, slush, ice or frost, or is wet and is associated with clearing or treatment of snow, slush, ice or frost, the runway condition report should be disseminated through the AIS and the ATS services. But when the runway is wet and is not associated with the presence of standing water, snow, slush, ice or frost, the assessed information should be disseminated using runway condition report through ATS only. So now we have understood that RCR is initiated whenever there is a change in runway condition. So what are the steps involved in RCR generation from the point of view of a pilot? Once the runway condition code or the RCR is disseminated to the pilot, they use this information to determine the aircraft's performance. They correlate the code with the performance data by the aircraft manufacturer. This helps them to calculate the takeoff and landing performance on wet or contaminated runways. So, upon landing, they report their own observations on the runway condition. So, this either confirms the runway condition code or provides an alert on the changing runway conditions. We will understand how the RCR is correlated with the aircraft performance in the coming slides. So, now that we have understood the background of GRF, let us understand the meaning of the most commonly used words during the discussion, that is the runway condition code and the RCAM. The runway condition code is a number describing the runway surface condition and is used in RCR. The numbers starting from 0 to 6 are used to do as the runway condition code. 6 refers to a dry runway. 5 refers to a runway that is contaminated by frost or is wet and has contaminant of depth 3 mm or less. And the contaminant may be slush, dry snow or wet snow. Similarly, you can read the contaminant type and the runway condition code used accordingly. In many countries like India, where the major contaminant is only water from rain and there is no snow, slush, ice on the runway, the matrix of runway condition code can be reduced and the codes 6, 5, 3 and 2 can be used, where 6 refers to a dry runway, 5 refers to a wet runway with contaminant depth 3 mm or less, 3 refers to a slippery and wet runway where the depth of water is more than 3 mm and 2 refers to a runway having standing water of depth more than 3 mm. Now let us understand what is RCAM or the Runway Condition Assessment Matrix. It is a matrix allowing the assessment of runway condition code using associated procedures from a set of observed runway surface conditions and pilot's report of braking action. Basically, the table or the assessment criteria of runway condition code is combined with the criteria of pilot's report of braking action. Basically, you can use this table to understand what ideally should be the pilot's report of braking action. Suppose the runway condition code is 5. In that case, the runway is wet and has a water of depth not more than 3 mm. In that case, ideally the pilot's report of braking action should be good. That is, the braking deceleration is normal for the wheel braking effort applied and the directional control is normal. So similarly, you can read what is the associated braking action that is to be reported based on each runway condition code from this runway condition assessment matrix. Summarizing, the correlation between runway condition code and braking action is that if the runway condition code is 5, the braking action is good. If the runway condition code is 4, the braking action is good to medium. If the runway condition code is 3, the braking action is medium. If the runway condition code deteriorates to 2, the braking action is medium to poor. When the runway condition code is 1, the braking action is poor. And when the runway condition code is 0, the braking action is less than poor. So that is all for the first part of the video on global reporting format. Hope you are clear on the role of the different stakeholders involved and hope you have understood the basic terms related to the global reporting format. So stay tuned for the second part of this video coming up next Sunday, where we will understand the assessment and adjustment of the runway condition code. And we'll also understand the entire concept of this reporting by using an example. Aviation Abhi, go where you feel the most alive. Do not forget to like, share and subscribe because your support is our greatest motivation. This is Anvesha Pal signing off. Thank you.